Swayam Prabha. Digital India. Educated India.
Today, we will look at granulomatous inflammation. What you have seen so far pertains to chronic inflammation. And this is a very specific type of chronic inflammation. And today we will look at the definition. What is the definition of granulomatous inflammation? We will then look at the accompaniments. Of granulomatous inflammation, and then we will look at the causes of granulomatous inflammation. What is a granuloma, or what is meant by granulomatous inflammation? Granulomatous inflammation is signified by the presence of a granuloma. And the granuloma, by definition, is an aggregate of epithelioid cells. It is very important that you note the spelling of this word, epithelioid, epithelioid. It is an aggregate or a nodular collection of epithelioid cells. This is the minimum requirement for a granuloma. Everything else, the accompaniments in a granuloma, are more for decoration. The essential composition of a granuloma is the aggregate or a nodular collection of epithelioid cells, which I will explain to you. Now, what is an epithelioid cell? Now, let us go beyond, just to make us understand. What are the characteristics of an epithelioid cell? The epithelioid cell, the first thing one must understand, it is a macrophage or a histiocyte. The epithelioid cell is a macrophage which has become elongated. So, it is an elongated macrophage. This is the first thing one must remember. Even though it is called an epithelioid cell, it is a histiocyte or a macrophage which has become elongated. So, the epithelioid cell is an elongated macrophage. The second thing is, it resembles an epithelial cell. That is why it is called epithelioid, looks like, similar to. That is the meaning of the word oid. Oid means similar to, a cell which looks similar to an epithelial cell is an epithelioid cell. So, this epithelioid cell is a macrophage which looks like it on the face of it resembles an epithelial cell, therefore, it is called epithelioid cell. So, two characteristics: the epithelioid cell is a macrophage or a histiocyte, it is an elongated macrophage which looks similar to an epithelial cell. The third feature is this epithelioid cell has got plentiful cytoplasm . This epithelioid cell has got a vesicular nucleus. Abundant pink cytoplasm and a vesicular nucleus, an open nucleus, a nucleus which is not condensed, a nucleus which is described typically as vesicular. So, these are the characteristics of the epithelioid cell, the four important characteristics. It is also important to remember that these epithelioid cells, which we have given so much importance to, has certain properties in terms of its functions. The first one is it has no phagocytic activity. So, in terms of function, the epithelioid cell has no phagocytic activity. It, however, has secretory function. And the most well-known product, secretory product of the epithelioid cell is the angiotensin converting enzyme. ACE. So, these are the attributes of the epithelioid cell. It's a macrophage, it's an elongated macrophage, it resembles an epithelial cell, therefore, it is called epithelioid cell. It has got plentiful cytoplasm and it has got a vesicular nucleus. It has no phagocytic activity, but it has secretory functions, and the most important product, the well-known product of the epithelioid cell is the angiotensin converting enzyme. Having said that, we will now go on to the accompaniments. What are the accompaniments in a granuloma? We have now seen the definition. What we have seen so far is the definition of a granuloma. What are the accompaniments of a granuloma? For a granuloma, the minimum requirement is the epithelioid cells, and the epithelioid cells are sufficient for the diagnosis of a granuloma. However, there can be some accompaniments which can come in addition to the epithelial cell, which will be more like a decoration for a granuloma. The first accompaniment is what we call as the giant cell. Epithelioid cells, when they fuse together, they form giant cells, and the giant cells are two types, what is called the Langhans type of giant cell and the foreign body type of giant cell. The Langhans giant cell, please note the word Langhans, it has nothing to do with Langerhans. Langhans giant cell, it may be written with an apostrophe or as is the custom now, there is no apostrophe needed. The Langhans giant cell is the result of fusion of several epithelioid cells and it looks, the nuclei are arranged in the periphery and this arrangement in the periphery is often described as horseshoe shaped arrangement of the nuclei. So, this horseshoe shaped arrangement of the nucleus, there is plenty of cytoplasm, pink cytoplasm. The nucleus arranged in the shape of a horseshoe, this is called Langhans type of giant cell. The foreign body type of giant cell differs in the arrangement of the nuclei. Here the nuclei can be arranged in a very random fashion, no particular order, no particular arrangement, it can be in any order. Several nuclei, sometimes up to 50 or even 100 nuclei, and this too has got abundant pink cytoplasm, but more important, the arrangement of the nucleus is random. So, this is called foreign body and this is random arrangement of nucleus. So, that is the first accompaniment which is associated with a granuloma. The second accompaniment in a granuloma is caseation necrosis. A granuloma, as I mentioned to you, is a collection of epithelioid cells. These are elongated cells which aggregate So, these are epithelioid cells which aggregate, form a nodule and this is enough to call something a granuloma. Sometimes these epithelioid cells fuse together and form the giant cell. So, this is the Langhans giant cell. So, this is the first accompaniment I mentioned about. The second thing that can happen is the central part of the granuloma can undergo necrosis and this is the second accompanying feature in any granuloma. This is often described as caseation necrosis. Caseation means cheese like necrosis. When you look at it naked eye, the necrotic area appears cheese like. So, caseation necrosis is the second accompanying feature. The third accompanying feature of this granuloma is the presence of lymphocytes. Around the granuloma, you get lymphocytes. So, lymphocytes constitute the third accompanying feature in a granuloma. It is the response of the body to whatever is the causative agent for the granuloma. So, it is the presence of the lymphocytes usually at the periphery that will seem to complete the picture of a granuloma. So, the presence of lymphocytes often in the periphery or around the granuloma is a usual accompaniment of granuloma. The next is the presence of fibroblasts. In a granuloma, you sometimes get again around the granuloma, you often get fibroblasts. Which can be an accompanying feature. Please note that these are not necessary for a granuloma. These are additional, these are accompaniments. The essential requirement for a granuloma is the collection of epithelioid cells. If any of these things are present, these will be additional, these will be more of decorative value. It might only make the granuloma very prominent when you view it because of the presence of the giant cell, the caseation necrosis, the lymphocytes and the fibroblasts. We may also note that if in a granuloma, if you see eosinophils, it is an indication of parasitic infection. So, the presence of eosinophils in a granuloma is an indication of this having a parasitic origin. Having said that, we have now seen the definition, we have then seen the accompaniments, we will now go to the causes of granuloma. Now, what are the important causes of granuloma? The most important causes of granuloma you could easily see in a tabular column in a textbook. But I am going to present to you an approach to remembering these important causes. The first set of causes are infections. This is the first set of causes. Among the causes, we will look at infections. Now, if you look at infections, there is an easy way to remember the important infections. And the easy way to remember it is as remember the important infections as flats. Fungal infections, leprosy, atypical mycobacteria, tuberculosis, and syphilis. There are several infections, but the most important infections can best be remembered with this mnemonic FLATS. So, that is one reason, an important reason in India why granulomas happen. The second cause for granuloma is material which are not digested, material which are not digested or phagocytosed, material which are not easily phagocytosed, they are a cause of granuloma. This could be because of endogenous or exogenous reasons. Endogenous could be keratin, cholesterol, exogenous things coming from outside. Simple two examples, one is talc, the other one is suture. So, this is the second reason, one is infections, second is materials which are not digested, not easily phagocytosed. The third reason is chemicals which cannot be easily handled by the body's cells, and the most well known of them is beryllium. Beryllium is an important chemical which is responsible for causing granulomas in the body. So, this is the third cause for granuloma. Then we have certain unknown causes. So, we have seen infections, we have seen materials, we have seen chemicals, then we have unknown causes, and among the most important causes for granuloma for which we do not know the reason, one is Crohn's disease, the other one is sarcoidosis. There is another condition called Wegener's granulomatosis. All these represent important causes of granuloma. Of course, there could be a range of conditions, but at least broadly you can classify them as infections, then materials which cannot be digested, chemicals, and unknown. Now, let us look at the pictures linked to what I have explained to you, and we will try to understand what I have been explaining to you on the board. What you see here is a collection of epithelioid cells. These are macrophages which have become elongated, and these elongated macrophages are the epithelioid cells. Please note the spelling of the word epithelioid. These epithelioid cells, as I mentioned to you, have abundant cytoplasm and they have vesicular nuclei. The nuclei are more open, and that vesicular nuclear characteristic and the lighter colored cell, all the cells that you see on the screen represent the epithelioid cells. Now, it may so happen that these epithelioid cells, as you can see on the top right, there is arrangement of nuclei in the form of a horseshoe. I mentioned that to you, the horseshoe shaped arrangement, and this is referred to as the Langhans giant cell. Langhans giant cells are nothing but epithelioid cells which have fused and formed a horseshoe pattern. So, here are epithelioid cells plus Langhans giant cells. Here is a lung tissue, and you can see the granuloma. In the center, you see the epithelioid cells with two Langhans giant cells. At the periphery, surrounding this granuloma, you observe the darker colored cells, which are the lymphocytes. So, here is a granuloma with epithelioid cells with two Langhans giant cells, and at the periphery, you see the lymphocytes. You will, of course, see adjacent to the granuloma lung tissue. Here is yet another picture of a granuloma, a close up of what we saw earlier. This time again we are seeing the epithelioid cells forming the granuloma. Then you see at least four Langhans giant cells. Two of them are quite big, abundant pink cytoplasm and the horseshoe shaped arrangement. And then you also see at the periphery the lymphocytes, which are the darker colored cells. Yet again, a look at multiple granulomas. Here you see a small granuloma, a medium sized granuloma, and another granuloma. So, there are maybe three or four granulomas. They all have epithelioid cells, and almost all of them have one or more Langhans type of giant cells. Please note the arrangement of the nuclei in the form of a horseshoe, almost like a garland, and this horseshoe shaped arrangement is what gives it the name Langhans giant cell. This is a close up of the Langhans giant cell. you see the abundant pink cytoplasm and the arrangement of the nuclei in the form of a horseshoe. This is another picture to show the granuloma. You see three Langhans giant cells, and the cells in between, the lighter colored cells, you see are the epitheloid cells, and at the periphery you see the darker colored lymphocytes. Here is a picture to show you the foreign body type of giant cells. Here you find several cells, and these cells, the giant cells, have nuclei arranged in a very random haphazard manner. When you have a close-up of that, here is a look at the foreign body type of giant cell. Here you can see the nuclei are arranged in a very random fashion, abundant pink cytoplasm, and the cell of course is a giant cell. As you can see, it is a huge cell, quite gigantic in its shape, and that is why it is called the giant cell. So, the foreign body giant cell has no particular arrangement of nuclei. One other accompaniment in a granuloma is what is referred to as caseation necrosis. There is destruction of tissue, and if you can see here in the center, you find the tissue has been completely destroyed, and what you see here is a pinkish material which represents caseation necrosis. And of course, there is a Langhans type of giant cell at the periphery, and there is caseation necrosis, and then there are these epithelioid cells, and at the periphery there are lymphocytes. Here is yet another picture to show you in focus what happens in caseation necrosis. The entire tissue has been destroyed and it is homogeneous pink in appearance. So, caseation necrosis may be found in tuberculosis, but caseation necrosis is not a requirement all the time. All other accompaniments, when they are present, it is okay, but what we have to remember at the end of it all, a granuloma is a collection of epithelioid cells. That is enough, that is sufficient for the diagnosis of a granuloma. Everything else that happens is only going to add on, and it will not in any way change. At the same time, if all other things are present but epithelioid cells are not present, then you cannot call it a granuloma. I hope you have understood today the importance of this epithelioid cell in a granuloma. That is the most important cell in a granuloma. Everything else is secondary, and we have seen the major causes for granulomatous inflammation, and we have seen that it is necessary for us to recognize granuloma on the presence of these epithelioid cells. Thank you very much.